I'm excited to present this study on the evolution of horror film music and its compositional traits and historical origins. The horror film genre has been significantly influenced by composers of serialism, modernism, post-World War II modernism, the avant-garde movement, and minimalism in the 20th century. The findings of this research will conclusively link the compositional style of horror film score composers to the style of 20th century art music composers. This research piece will highlight the prominent composers that paved the way for the development of horror film music, specific applications of musical devices that were created as an innovative soundscape for film, and the psychological effects genre-specific oral devices have on an audience. The following presentation of these findings will explore how these musical devices are seen in horror films today and how horror film music has evolved into a musically autonomous subgenre. So what does fear sound like? We all know that music is used in film as a tool to elicit emotional responses, but there actually have been studies on the psychophysiological response to film music, and it indicates that there is a difference between what these researchers call increased condition music and decreased condition music. So basically, increased condition music has attributes such as repetitive figures based on diminished seventh chords and harsh timbres. And decreased condition music has attributes such as mildly active chord progressions based on major seventh chords. And these are overly simplified. However, I think it really highlights the difference between something that is simply consonant and something that is dissonant or harsh in a sense. And what these studies have found is that increased condition music produces higher heart rates and epidermal responses, which is fairly obvious, but it's interesting to see from a scientific standpoint. 18th and 19th century composers use minor tonality and strategic chromaticism to elicit increased conditions. However, once we move into the 20th century, composers of art music began experimenting more with atonality, timbre or regularity, and non-traditional sound production to elicit these increased conditions. So, a brief history of film music, and I say brief, and it will be very brief. The use of music in film has been common practice since the silent film. The timeline of film music predates the sound in films, but during the early years of Hollywood productions, music for film was not composed as a connected entity. Theaters during this era of film employed in-house musicians, typically a pianist or an organist, who was tasked with the job of accompanying the on-screen images. At the turn of the century, movie music became increasingly diegetic, meaning it played an on-screen role for the story. Production companies began to print cue sheets for their films as guidelines on which style of music went with each scene. The true genre of film music, however, did not exist until the advent of the talkie or the sound film. As the genre developed, the idea of cohesively integrated music as a narrative enhancement became the forefront. This concept had its roots most notably in the operas of Richard Wagner, who viewed his works as a tonal work of art, encompassing music, poetry, drama, and visual elements all into one genre. Throughout the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, also known as the Golden Age of Film, composers scored diegetic themes with the leitmotifs of Wagner, characteristics of German Romanticism, sweeping orchestration, tonal melodies, and harmonic progressions. This style remained the standard for several decades, as the theme of many films this time also reflected a sentimental, romantic ideal. The idea of the character leitmotif, diegetic scoring, and music that directly corresponded to the action on screen was quickly becoming a standard in Hollywood, and composers of film music were becoming increasingly in demand. This period was crucial for the idea of film music as its own genre. But the development of 20th century modernism and the avant-garde movement changed the way composers approached the film scoring process. Modernist composers, as early as Stravinsky, were composing highly agitated music that would send audience members literally running from the theaters and mobbing and rioting, which is exactly what kind of emotional response a composer of film scores for horror film are looking for. So you can kind of see this trend rolling its way towards the second half of the 20th century. The avant-garde approach to composition became a standard for the horror genre beginning in the 1970s, largely credited to the success of the film The Exorcist, and its soundtrack, and the films of Stanley Kubrick. And the films of Stanley Kubrick, as well as The Exorcist, did not have an original score. However, they sampled pieces that were previously composed by these avant-garde and modernist composers, such as Krzysztof Penderecki and Georges Ligeti. So we're going to go through some of these 20th century influences through art music and the role that they play in the development of the specific genre. And what you'll see as we go through the progression of these composers is that they are, in a sense, all linked together, whether by study or teacher-student relationships or just peer-to-peer relationships. So it's pretty interesting how you can see the connection. So first we're going to talk about Charles Ives. What has sound got to do with music? For Ives, music is not mere sound, but the underlying spirit, human and divine. He was considered an innovator of sound for composition in America, and he experimented with polytonality, quotation, style blending, and the soundscape. So, sounds of life, blending of different sounds in an environment, and what he called moving music. But however, he was largely unknown as a composer until after his death. So he was doing a lot of very innovative things in composition before anyone else was doing them. However, he didn't necessarily have a direct influence until much, much later. Some of his influential works include Central Park After Dark, The Unanswered Question, Country Band March, Sonata No. 2 for Piano, Concord Mass, General Williams' Booth Enters into Heaven, and Song Without Words. And I have here a clip. Of Central Park After Dark. Henry Cowell is a modernist, ultra-modernist, post-modernist composer. Many consider him an innovator of the modernist movement in America. He actually studied under Carl Singer, who introduced Cowell to the latest modernist compositional techniques from Europe and the United States. And he was also a friend and close confidant and contemporary of Charles Ives. His compositional innovations include the tone cluster, string piano, which he would actually go inside the piano and pluck or stroke or strum the strings inside the piano. He later influenced techniques used by Nan Caro, Elliot Carter, Karlheinz Stockhausen, and other postmodernists. His compositional style includes experimental sound production, mathematical rhythms, non-Western instruments, and sounds. He was actually a teacher of students such as John Cage. So again, you can see this connection, this linear connection, coming really from America, in a sense, although it was happening overseas in Europe as well. Some of his influential works include the banjo, Aeolian harp, concerto for piano and orchestra, and I have a clip of the banjo, which makes the use of his string piano techniques. The composer of indeterminacy. He studied under Henry Kell, as stated earlier, and Arnold Schoenberg. He innovated the art of indeterminacy, use of electronic sounds, and he was heavily influenced by Zen, Dadaism, silence, and atonal techniques. He's quoted by saying, "My music now makes use of time brackets, sometimes flexible, sometimes not. There are no scores, no fixed relation of parts. Sometimes the parts are fully written out, sometimes not. We are living in a period in which many people have changed their minds about the use of music is or could be for them. Music that transports the listener to the moment where he is." So you can really see how this kind of mindset plays into the creation of horror film scores later on. Some of his influential works include Water Music, Metamorphosis, First Construction in Metal, Third Construction, Percussion Quartet, 13, Bacchanal, and In the Name of the Holocaust. And I have for you a clip of Bacchanal. All right, Ion Xenakis, he began composing later in life. He's a Greek composer and lived in Europe at the time. And he is heavily influenced and educated in mathematics as well as architecture. He studied with Henri Messiaen and he was influenced by the Musique Concrète movement. His use of electronics, computer technology, and algorithms give his music a very distinct character. He's considered part of the avant-garde or postmodernist movement, and some of his influential works include Metastasis, Ata, Lukos, Nuits, Nishima, and Nomos Alpha. And I have a clip of Metastasis for you.
An ordinary jar of Vaseline jelly. It's something.
As soon as this ad is over.
Don't think about much, except when we've got chapped lips or a small cut. But for people living in areas in crisis, simple skin conditions can turn into serious issues. So we could.
Georges Ligeti, described as one of the most important avant-garde composers in the latter half of the 20th century. He studied under Kadosa, Farkas, Kodály, and Veres. He studied and was influenced by the work of Karlheinz Stockhausen. Again, so you see this linear connection. He invented such techniques as micropolyphony and made use of polyrhythms, electronic sounds, and static harmonies. He became very well known in pop culture for the use of his music in major motion pictures, most notably Stanley Kubrick. Stanley Kubrick loved the music of Georges Ligeti, and he used him in his films such as 2001, A Space Odyssey, and then later The Shining. Some of his influential works, which actually appear in these films, are Atmospheres, Volumina, Lux Aeterna, Magyar Etudok, Ramifications, and Lotano. And I have a clip for you of Lotano. Stockhausen, German composer, one of the most influential and unique voices in the post-World War II European musical avant-garde. He studied with Messiaen and had interactions with Boulez as well as Pierre Schaeffer. He forged relationships with Ligeti and Cage and Lamont Young. His compositional techniques include electronic music, aleatory serial composition, and musical spatialization. His influential works include Gruppen for Three Orchestra, Helicopter Quartet, Contrapunti, and I have a clip here of Gruppen. All right, Krzysztof Penderecki, horror director's favorite composer, as I like to call him, and he truly was. He became a featured player in horror and science fiction films. And again, Stanley Kubrick loved him, as well as he was seen in The Exorcist, The Shining, and Shutter Island. So his music really has become synonymous with the idea of horror and fear. There have been music critics that are quoted by saying much of his music is not for the faint of heart. This music occupies a sound world that can often be described as terrifying, and that's from National Public Radio. Compositions are characterized by pushing instruments to their sonic limits, eerie string effects, microtones, textures of sound masses and colors, non-standard playing techniques, and the use of tone clusters. And some of his influential works, which can also be seen in The Exorcist and The Shining, are Canon for Orchestra and Tape, Polymorphia, St. Luke's Passion, Dies Irae, The Devils of Loudun, Anaglossis, and De Natura Sonora. And I have a clip here from The Exorcist. I believe it's from Canon for Orchestra and Tape. Thank you. Again, his work is especially influential in the fact that after The Exorcist, that type of sound landscape really became the standard for horror films. Before that, it was fairly tonal in a sense. Just the style, the shape, the texture, it was very much more consonant and traditional. But after his work being featured in The Exorcist, the game kind of changed. Right, and the five, Lamont Young and Philip Glass. And Lamont Young, he's considered by many as the father of modern minimalism. And he had major experiments with long tones and the Western drone music. So you can also see this thread extending into the horror film genre, in a sense. He was interested in both 12-tone music as well as Cagean conceptualism, and that led directly to the style known today as minimalism. He did a 1959 summer course in Darmstadt with Stockhausen, who exposed Young to John Cage's philosophies on indeterminacy and found sounds. Some of his influential works include X for Henry Flint, Composition 1960, and The Well-Tuned Piano. And I'm going to go ahead and skip to Philip Glass. You think of minimalist composers, this is probably the guy that's going to come up first in your mind. He's very famous in pop culture. He's actually done original film scores for major motion pictures. Some of them include The Illusionist, The Hours, and Notes on a Scandal, which he received awards for these film scores. And really, minimalism has become a set sound for film scores, not just in the horror film genre, but in all the film genres. And the sounds that he produces really play a hand in that type of sound. He studied with Mahaud and Boulanger. Glass himself never liked the term minimalism and preferred to speak of himself as a composer of music with repetitive structures. His compositional style is characterized by repetitive melodic structures, additive rhythms, plain consonant harmonies, rhythmic subtlety, and extensive use of ostinato. So you can really see how that would play into the film score itself. I have a clip here of his piece Gone. It's not necessarily his most well-known work, but it very much gives you a sense of the film score sound. So now that we've explored some of the key players and compositional influences of the 20th century, I really want to dive into some of the characteristic devices of horror film music, as well as give you a bit of a chronological study of some of the more influential horror films of the second half of the 20th century, specifically beginning in 1968 through present day. So what I've done is I've spent many sleepless nights and given myself some stomach ulcers and nightmares listening to all of these film scores that are included in the study extensively all the way through. And what I've done is I've split up all of these characteristic devices into six different categories. So the categories that I've split them up into are harmonic devices, motivic devices, use of strings, which is extremely important in horror film scoring, as well as textural devices, use of synthesizer, and special effects. So quickly, I'm just going to go through this list. And if you're particularly interested or curious and you want a little bit better of a sense of what some of these include, I can definitely, just contact me and I'll let you know. But I guess it's not letting me go back, but I'll go ahead and go through some of these on this slide. Textural devices include textural addition, which is basically like adding on of sounds from very thin orchestration to heavy orchestration. Slow dynamic and textural growth, densely scored sound masses, moments of silence, mixed and asymmetrical meter. A good example of this would be my Oldfield's tubular bells, alternation between thick and thin orchestration, slow, low to high range transition, extreme dynamic and textural changes, textural layering, and delayed sense of time. Now, the use of synthesizer is particularly interesting in horror films. It really plays a major role beginning in the 1980s and into the 90s, and it's seen fairly common place in horror film scores today. Although it's seen as sort of a stylistic trait of film scores of the 80s and 90s particularly. So drone synthesizers, some of the sounds you'll hear, drone synthesizers, oscillating synthesizer, mixed textures of synthesizers, so low sounds, high sounds, oscillating, straight tone, all that kind of stuff mixed together. Replicated nature sounds such as insects or wind. Mixture of synthesizer and orchestra, which become particularly commonplace beginning in the 90s. Reverberated synthesizer sounds, rhythmic melodies that are 100% or mainly produced by synthesized instruments. And some of these synthesized instruments can be brass, piano, or even vocal synthesizer. And then a characteristic that I like to call the heartbeat, which you'll hear in the film score for The Thing, but it shows up later on and it's literally a synthesized sound of a heartbeat, bell tones, and white noise sounds. Now, the special effects column is extremely interesting to me. Although you don't see these exclusively in horror film scores, these are some things that you will see in most horror film scores. And what they've done is they've used these devices to kind of play into the human emotion and kind of draw out that fear during films. So some of these might include instruments played outside of the normal tessitura, so very extreme lows or highs. What I call the stinger, and everyone knows what the stinger is. You can have a moment of silence before or after, particularly before, and then a very loud pointillistic chord, the dump, the jump scare basically that goes with it. Ritualistic vocal chanting, so anything that would sound either tribal or ritualistic in nature, and it can be pitched or non-pitched. Dissonant vocal lines, religious chant and song, and particularly with Latin text that, and this is really connected to storylines that are either demonic or what I like to call non-religious or anti-religious. So it's an ironic play on the feeling of church or religious musical settings juxtaposed to demonic forces or characters. Vocal glissando, brass bell flare, sudden silence, flutter tongue, woodwind and brass flutter tongue, woodwind and brass glissando, ritualistic percussion, which I characterize as anything that sounds either tribal or very driving rhythm, heavy orchestration. Some of these percussion interludes might sound like they're using sticks or stones or shells or bones. So anything that sounds very earthy, very driving, and very tribal or ritualistic. Heavily scored percussion, use of organ harp or church bells, again, in an ironic juxtaposition to a demonic force in the film or a demonic or demon possession storyline. And bowed percussion, which gives that glassy sound, and the use of vocal drones. Aside from those three, which I didn't get to go back to the original screen that had the first three categories, of course, what you're going to see melodically and harmonically is mostly a lack of tonal center. And you may have repetitive or driving motoric rhythms, repetitive melodic themes that actually tie to a particular character, or the arrival of a character, or the anticipation of a character, like the Jaws half-step motive, which I'll get into later. But in a sense, minimalism plays into that area, and its role is more heavily influencing the motivic devices of the horror film score. Now, the use of strings, what you're going to hear is collegno, so basically turning the bow of the instrument onto its wooden side and playing the strings from that side, so it gives it a very percussive feel. And of course, you're going to hear the obligatory glissando, the tremolo, what I like to call the tremolo glissando, which is glissing and tremolo at the same time, and even melodies that include those in conjunction with playing the melodic line with a glissando or a tremolo involved. So you see a lot of these in play, and the string section of the orchestra plays a huge role in the horror film score. So now what I'm going to do is starting with Rosemary's Baby, and this really predates, obviously predates the Exorcist, but I added this in there because you can kind of see how the seed has been planted from the avant-garde movement and the modernist composers of its time. But it's a little more tonal in nature. And so I'm going to play a track from each one of these films, and I may say a word or two, but for the most part, I'm going to try and keep my mouth shut. So you can read what the overview of each film is, and I listened to the entire soundtrack of the film, and I've assigned these compositional characteristics from the previous list to the film. So you can listen and then study the list as you listen. So first is Rosemary's Baby, scored by Krzysztof Kamila. Particularly striking about this film score is their use of the lullaby or the childlike melody. And then if you listen through the soundtrack, you'll also hear a lot of jazz samplings, which kind of give that feel of modernism to it, and its real life setting. And this is one of three installations of the apartment trilogy. So it's an interesting storyline for sure. Okay, next we have the game changer, The Exorcist. This film literally set the tone for the entire genre. And what's interesting about it is that it does not have its own film score. William Peter Blatty's Exorcist, directed by William Friedkin, it only sampled previously scored and composed works. But they almost were exclusively 20th century composers. So Mike Oldfield's Tubular Bells, of course, is synonymous with this film, and it's actually quoted several times in other horror films and films of similar genres to give an automatic sense of fear. And it's really just connected to this film. And it's very minimalistic in nature. And then you have Night of the Electric Insects by George Crumb. You've got works by Krzysztof Kmita, like Polymorphia. And so it really is just a wonderful quilt, if you will, of music of this genre in art music. So right now I have a clip for you. And this is Night of the Electric Insects. There you go. So, most every score, save a few, were modeled after the soundtrack to this film. Okay, and everyone knows what this sounds like. It is so ingrained into our American pop culture that you can just sing that half-step melody and someone will know what is about to happen or what's going on. So what I call the half-step motive, even though it's not an obvious quotation, you hear this half-step motive so many times throughout the 1970s, 1980s, 90s, and then today. So I've actually given it its own category within the characteristic devices of film score composition. The half-step motive in itself is its own entity. And of course, John Williams is famous for his use of the leitmotif and assigning a specific motif with a character. So you know that when you hear that half-step motive, the shark is coming. And you'll see this later on in the works of John Carpenter and pretty much every other film after that. So I have just a little clip of the main theme, even though we all know what it sounds like. Frightening. All right, we have another, the third and final child demon possession, antichrist, or anti-religious, or whatever you want to call it, film in this study. Jerry Goldsmith is a huge player in scoring for not just horror film, but action films in the 1970s and 80s. And even 90s. He was also famous for scoring the Poltergeist film, which is another amazing film score if you have a chance to check it out, even though it's not an score. Oops. So I'm going, even though I can't go back to it, I'm going to go ahead and play a clip from the track Ave Satani. And what it does is it uses a church or a setting that is very liturgical in a sense. You're going to hear full choir, Latin text, but the text is actually demonic in nature. It's Ave Satani is translated Hail Satan. Hail Satan.
Hail thee, Lord.
church bells, piano, organ. Okay, so now I'm already on the Halloween screen. John Carpenter was a very interesting character in the fact that he directed as well as scored many of his films. And he started by saying that a lot of this had to do with budget, but it's a good thing that he didn't have enough money to hire out a studio orchestra and a composer to score his films, because some of the most well-known themes of the horror film genre come from his fully synthesized scores to his film. So everyone knows the Michael Myers theme from Halloween. And again, it's another really great example of the use of the leitmotif that directly connects to the anticipation of the arrival of a particular character and the building of fear in an audience. The entire score is synthesized, and you'll hear repetitive melodic motives and just driving melody. I'm just going to play a few seconds of it. Alright, so The Shining is another wonderful Stanley Kubrick movie. Of course, most of his films are masterpieces in their own right. But many of his film scores, like The Exorcist, were not originally scored for the film. So he did a lot of samplings of jazz and classical music, and a lot of it came from 20th century composers. So I have a clip from The Shining, and this is De Natura Sonoris number 2, and this is a Pandemic C. All right, The Thing, another John Carpenter film. This one is a little different in a sense that it was a very big budget motion picture. And the score to this film was not written by John Carpenter. It was actually written by Ennio Morricone. But when John Carpenter gave it to Ennio Morricone, Morricone really wanted to maintain that John Carpenter feel to the score. So, again, it is almost 100% completely synthesized instruments. And this is where you start to hear what I call the heartbeat. And I have a clip of the main theme for the thing. And I'm going to try and fast forward to where the heartbeat arrives. So this score really does encapsulate the sound of 1980s horror film. Film that, again, encapsulates that 1980s horror film feel is A Nightmare on Elm Street. This is scored by Charles Bernstein. And again, this is almost 100% completely synthesized instrument scoring. And it makes use of childlike melodies and repetitive melodic motives. You can hear the half-step motive. It's mainly in a minor tonality, so there's not a whole lot of atonalism, but it definitely rings true to the style of the decade. So I have a clip from... It just makes me not want to sleep at night. Okay, so now we skip pretty much a decade into the future. And the reason why I'm ahead is because a lot of what you hear in the 90s, particularly in films like Scream, The Sixth Sense, anything that, you know, I Know What You Did Last Summer. It takes everything that you've previously heard and it just kind of expands on its orchestration. So it sort of becomes very stereotypical, if you will. Once you get into the 2000s, however, I think composers began experimenting just a little bit more and kind of hearkening back to the original sense of its origins. So you're going to hear a little bit more minimalism. You're going to hear a little bit more avant-garde-ness. Definitely more atonal and a loss of a tonal center. Now, The Ring by Hans Zimmer is, I would say, very Philip Glass-esque, and it is tonal in a sense, but I think its use of minimalistic lines, childlike melodies, and the repetitive motives really kind of drive this score forward and makes it very unsettling.
Thank you.
Now we get to Joseph Bishara. This guy is definitely in the most recent years become A-list celebrity when it comes to music composers. He's red carpet ready at all times. And if somebody is doing a big budget horror film, they're gonna call this guy right now. And what he does is he basically takes everything that is unsettling about the avant-garde, modernist, minimalist movements, all of it, and turns it on its head. So, extremely harsh sounds from every instrument group, static motion, atonalism, polytonality, extreme changes in texture, dynamics, and just a really uneasy sense that there's nothing sacred in his compositions. So I have a clip here from the Insidious soundtrack, and this track is called Void Figures.
It's not for sure yet.
All right, now Cabin in the Woods, I think is a little bit of an aside in this study, but I add this in because the film itself, if you've never seen it, is almost a satirical play on the horror film genre itself, and the I think the film score very much reflects that in a sense. David Julian does a wonderful job at encapsulating the traditional feel of what the horror genre had developed into at this up to this point. But it's in a way pretty stereotypical, and it kind of sounds like what you would hear in the 90s horror films. And so anyway, I just put this in here because I think it's a good example of where we had come from and where we are at this point. And so I have a clip from the track called The Cellar. Okay, next we have another film that's scored by the ever infamous Joseph Bishara, The Conjuring. And there's really not a whole lot extra to say about this one, other than the fact that it's very similar to Insidious. And I don't know if you would consider it a weakness or strength of his compositional style, but you know a Joseph Bishara film score when you hear it. It just, there's something about it that is very identifiable. And so I have a track from The Conjuring. This is You Look Very Pretty.
Thank you.
Okay, now we get to, I try to be as unbiased as I possibly can in these studies, but I have to admit that film on the list is probably one of my favorite in the last decade. The Witch, or A New England Folktale, is composed by Mark Corvin. And I think what's striking about this film score is that I honestly believe that the film itself would not be anywhere near as unsettling and frightening as it would be if it hadn't been for this score, the wonderfully crafted score by Mark Corvin. And in an interview with Corvin, he describes the fact that in meetings with the producers and directors of this film, what they told him was they wanted a film score that had the essence of period music and the essence of maybe folk-like melodies and folk-like settings, but they didn't want it to be period music. They didn't want to have they didn't want a score that was set around old English folk tunes or harmonic progressions that fit within that time period. So what he did was he took a sampling of that style. Melodically, you can hear themes of it throughout. However, it is largely atonal. You're going to hear the use of female vocals that signify the witch's coven, if you will. Lots of tribal percussion, as I like to call it. And just this very long, drawn out, delayed sense of time. So it plays a lot on textures and really sound shapes. And also another interesting thing about this score is that he makes use of period instruments such as the hurdy-gurdy and other string instruments of the, you know, 16th, 17th century. All right, so I have a clip here, and it's actually the trailer for the film. So you get a clip of several different tracks.
Thank you.
the stuff nightmares are made of. Okay, and study with a clip from the Netflix original series Stranger Things. And the score of this series is written by Kyle Dixon and Michael Stein. And the reason why I add this in at the very end is because it really brings this whole idea of horror film scoring in full circle. So we've gone a full 360 at this point. And this storyline is set in the 1980s, although it's not necessarily a horror film or even in the horror genre as far as TV series go. But the composers of the theme and the score really wanted to give a reflection and an essence of that 1980s horror film genre. And so most of what you're going to hear is synthesized instruments, synthesized sounds. And you will hear stuff that really reflects scores like The Thing. And I know I heard The Thing. As soon as I heard The Thing, I was like, wow, that's Stranger Things. You'll hear Nightmare on Elm Street. It's all very much basically in the same vein. And I think they did a really great job of using music as a way to put audiences back into that frame of mind. And, you know, I've listened to different people talk about the score to this series, and they've all said the same thing. The music sets the stage for the whole feel. This, you know, Goonies meets X-Files or whatever you want to call it. So anyway, here's just a short clip of the main title. So I really hope you enjoyed this sweeping survey of the history and characteristic devices of the horror film score. And I hope that this gives you an inspiration to really explore the sounds that you hear in film. And I know it's really opened my eyes to what music does to an audience, and how really without the film score, these horror films really wouldn't have the same effect, you know. So anyway, thank you so much for listening, and go out there and watch some scary movies and get frightened. Thanks. Bye.